الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: مثل الجنة التي وعد المتقون فيها أنهار من ماء غير آسٍ وأنهار من لبن لم يتغير طعمه وأنهار من خمر لذة للشاربين وأنهار من عسل مصفى ولهم فيها من كل الثمرات ومغفرة من ربهم كمن هو خالد في النار وسقوا ماء حميما فقطع أمعاءهم. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher and protector. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, alhamdulillah, it's nice to be with all of you all, and it is incumbent upon all of us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of the blessings that he has blessed us with, especially that he keeps on giving us opportunities, chances to talk about him, to talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So today's topic, mashallah, is a very interesting topic. It is a stroll through the gardens of Jannah, through the gardens of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all paradise. So let's go to the very inception of mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. Who is Adam alayhi salatu wa salam? Our father Adam alayhi salatu wa salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created him and entered him into Jannah. So scholars mention that this particular Jannah that he entered him into is known as Jannatul Ibtila, which means a Jannah which was created specially for Adam alayhi salatu wa salam to test Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. As we all know the story, as how Adam alayhi salatu wa salam was tested in this very Jannah. He was asked not to eat a specific type of fruit in that garden, in that Jannah. But now the Jannah that we are going to talk about, or that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised us in the Akhirah, in the hereafter, is known as Jannatul Khuld, which means Jannah, a garden of eternity, where once one enters that garden, he is never going to exit it, and he is going to live in it, abide in it, dwell in it forever and ever, for an eternity. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. As we know the story, he was sent to this dunya. This all took place on a Friday. As the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Adam alayhi salatu wa salam was created on a Friday. He was admitted entry into Jannah on a Friday. And he was even sent to the face of this earth on a Friday. So mankind at large was sent to dunya. What is the purpose? Why were we sent to this world? What is the purpose of this life? Allah the Almighty, He mentions in the Noble Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah the Almighty, He has not created mankind or jinnkind for any other purpose other than His worship. So, you see, mankind from the very beginning until now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been sending messengers after messengers, prophets after prophets. The reason being, with one message which has three components to it. Number one, to pass the message that Allah the Almighty is the creator, He is the master, protector, nourisher, sustainer of this whole universe. And He is the one who is worthy of worship, who needs to be obeyed, and no partners must be associated unto Him. He is Allah. Part 2 of the message, that He sends down guidance through messengers and through different revelations. As we know, so many revelations have come to the face of this earth. And currently, Quran is the final testament of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the whole of mankind has to follow. The third part of it is that there is something known as death. There is something known as death. You see, all of us, alhamdulillah, we are mu'minun, we are believers. We believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we believe in the 6 articles of faith. But if we were to look around the world, there are people who perhaps deny Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or perhaps they would deny the malaika. Or they accept some other prophet, say as Jesus, Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, as to be the final prophet, and they, you see, the followers of Christianity, for example, or Judaism for that matter. On the other hand, we also have a small group of so-called intellectuals who claim otherwise, who say that there is no God, no God at all. They deny completely the existence of a supreme being who created all of us. Even them, they deny all of this, but no one on the face of this earth denies the reality of death. Everyone inevitably, we accept that there is something known as death. For death overtakes every single human being. No one can escape the reality of death. Such is the matter of death. So this is certain. So part 3 of the message is death is certain. It is going to overtake each and every human being. And we Muslimun, we Mu'minun, we believe that just as how we die in this world, Allah the Almighty is going to resurrect us in the Akhirah. مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that from this earth, from this soil, we created you, O mankind. مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ. And to it we will return you all. Why? Because once you die, you'll be buried. You'll go back to this soil. وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. And once again from this very soil, we shall resurrect you. So we believe in the resurrection in the hereafter, that Allah the Almighty will resurrect us in the hereafter. So my dear brothers in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the life of this dunya as a test. Temporary life. Short life. All of us here perhaps will be 15 years, 20 years, 25, 30. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported and said that the life of this dunya is within 60 to 70 years. Within 60 to 70 years. So if you're 30, for example, you've just got another half more to go. Such a short span of life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed all of us for one reason, to test us, to see which of us would pass the test, pass the examination. This is how we cram for an examination in school. We need to understand that this life, the life of dunya, is the biggest test of all. You fail in a worldly examination, although I'm not asking you to fail, you should study well. But just in case you fail, you have the chance to resit that examination. You can resit the paper. You can try again. Not 1 year, twice, thrice, you can keep on trying. But the scary part of the examination of this dunya, my dear brothers in Islam, is that if you fail this dunya and the akhirah. You're a loser. You completely lose. There is no chance for you to resit the exam. There is no chance for you to resit the test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this life, my dear brothers in Islam, has been given to us as a test. As a test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ فَمَنْ آمَنَ وَأَصْلَحَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ. And we send not the messengers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that we send the messengers, except we only send the messengers as bringers of good tidings, and likewise they are warners. the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whoever believes and reforms, whoever believes in the messengers of Allah, the messages of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and reforms themselves, there will be no fear concerning them, nor will they ever grieve in this world or the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all successful in this world and the hereafter. So this is an imperfect world that we live in. And when we say imperfect, what we mean is, the pleasures are short-lived. The pleasures of this dunya are short-lived. Or the pleasures of this dunya are mixed with sorrows and grief. It is not permanent. Whatever happiness you face in this dunya, nothing is permanent. All of the pleasures of this dunya are short-lived. So this dunya, in reality, it is an imperfect life. But it is a perfect testing ground. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created it as a perfect testing ground to see which of us are going to pass this examination. So my dear brothers in Islam, we need to live in this dunya. We need to live in this dunya, just as how I posted a status on Facebook the other day. We need to live in this dunya just as how a driver would be driving on a highway at high speeds. Say you're on the Southern Expressway. You're traveling at what? 110 kilometers per hour or 120 kilometers per hour, above the speed limit a bit. So you're traveling at high speeds. Now would you be looking around and would you be talking to your family whilst you walk, whilst you drive? Would you be looking around and looking at the scenery whilst you're driving at high speeds? No. You would be looking right in front. You would be careful as you drive, because you know on a highway, the slightest mistake would result in a catastrophe, in an accident which would result in the loss of many lives. So we will be extremely careful. Why? Because we are behind the wheel and we are responsible for the other lives who are with us in the vehicle. So a driver who is driving on a highway, he would be driving with extreme concentration, his destination right in front of him. Kilometers going past, his destination, for example, is goal, so he's driving towards goal. Likewise, my dear brothers in Islam, our destination is al-akhirah, the hereafter. So we need to drive in this life with akhirah right in front of us. Don't be misled by the fake pleasures of this dunya, which are all fake mirages. All fake mirages that this dunya, they all wails that this dunya, she uses it to adorn herself with these fake pleasures, trying to deceive us. So let's not be deceived by this dunya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. Now my dear brothers in Islam, we move to the gates of Jannah. We move to the gates of Jannah. And when I say the gates of Jannah, I'm not literally talking about the gates of Jannah. I'm talking about how we could get into Jannah before we go into Jannah by itself. So I'm not going to talk, there are many gates, there are many ways to get into Jannah. I'm just going to talk about one, because I just prepared for one particular gate, and this is an important gate of Jannah. And what is that gate, my dear brothers in Islam? Try to guess, anybody? Doing your homework on time. What is it? Any gates of Jannah? Okay, I'll help you. Serving your mother. Serving your mother. This is one of the biggest gates of Jannah. Allah the Almighty, He says in the Noble Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ أَنِ اشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرُ وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ. And we have enjoined upon man, the care for his parents. His mother carried him weakness upon weakness. وَهْنَ عَلَى وَهْنٍ. We know, my dear brothers in Islam, for example, if you have a sibling, you have a brother or a younger brother or a younger sister, where you would have seen your mother pregnant with your younger brother or younger sister, or now that you are grown up, you all would know, from the very beginning of the pregnancy, your mother becomes weak. Weak as the months go. She has to bear the child for 9 months. For 9 months. Gradually she goes weak, 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 because the baby is growing. She, at times she cannot eat, at times she cannot sleep on one side. These are the difficulties that our mothers went through to bring us to the world. And now we are seated here. Our mothers, especially when you compare mothers and fathers, yes, of course, together. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given preference to the mother over the father, because the mother goes through a lot in giving birth, in bringing you all to the world, in bringing all of us to this world, and where we are today. So Allah says, وَهَنْ عَلَىٰ وَهَنْ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ. And the mothers can only wean their children or stop milking their children, giving milk to their children after 2 years. For 2 years, the mothers, they give milk, they breastfeed their children. So أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, we have enjoined upon you all to care for your parents so that you will be grateful to me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you will be grateful to me and to your parents. And Allah then goes on to say, and to me is the final destination, you all are going to return to me. There are many ahadith, my dear brothers in Islam, there are many ahadith which highlight the importance of behaving well with your mother, serving your mother. There was once a sahabi, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked permission from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to participate in jihad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, is your mother alive? To which he replies, yes. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructs him to go and serve your mother. He goes again and asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he wants to join jihad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again instructs him, go and serve your mother, for you will find Jannah by your mother. Allahu Akbar. There is a narration that says that Jannah is under the feet of your mothers. But it is a weak narration, and some scholars go on to say that even the narration is fabricated. But there are many other ahadith. There are many other ahadith which come, you know, go along the lines of those same words, which indicate that you will find Jannah by your mother. Many ahadith which say the same meaning. So with that we come to the conclusion, my dear brothers in Islam, that by serving your mother, you find Jannah. By serving your mother, you find Jannah, and she is one of the biggest gates for your entry into Jannah. Now there is a story to which I would like to share with you all, and I think it has done its rounds all over the place, so maybe you would have heard about it already. There was once a young boy, just like all of us, I'm also young, like you guys. Understand? Young boy, he and his mother, his father, he did not have his father. So, this boy, he used to go to school, he used to spend time with his friends, and one day, okay, in regard to his mother had only one eye. On the other eye, she was wearing a patch. She had only one eye. You know, like the pirates, they wear patches. The mother was wearing a patch on one eye. And once when he was in school with all of his friends, you know, he's having a party time with his friends, his mother comes to pick him up from school. He's a young boy. The mother comes to pick him up from the school, and his friends all run away. They run away and they say, they start making fun of him. Oh, look, who has come? The pirate mother has come. The one-eyed mother. And they scream and they run about. This boy is so ashamed and he is so angry that his mother came to visit him or pick him from school, that he goes straight to his mother when he reaches home and he starts screaming at her. Why did you come to pick me up? Why did you come to pick me up? You made me a laughing stock in front of all of my friends. My friends are mocking me and making fun of me. You're so ugly and this and that. And he started hurting his mother. And this gradually started building in him. He was oblivious to the fact that his mother was the biggest ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was forgetting that. And he started building hatred towards his mother, and he was waiting for the opportunity to break off from his mother and move away from his house. He was an intelligent boy, he worked hard in school, he got a sponsor to perhaps go abroad and study in some big university. So he grabs the opportunity, leaves his mother, goes somewhere abroad and starts studying, forgets about his mother. He forgets about his mother, saying, I don't want to think about that ugly lady. He studies, he secures a good job. And now he marries in that country where he is studying. He gets children and is living far away, completely forgotten about his mother. When his children ask about his mother, he says that she's sick or perhaps she's dead. Allah save us all. So one day this mother, after all my dear brothers in Islam, whatever sin you do, whatever wrong you do, whatever mistake you commit, the mother's love is as such that she yearns for the child. She misses the child. Just because you're naughty, your mother has never thrown you out of the house. Thrown you out of the house? No. The mother loves the child. So she's yearning to visit her son. And one day what she does is, she goes to visit her son. She finds out where her son is living and she goes to that country. When she reaches the house of her son, she's proud. My son, he's got a huge house. Range Rover parked outside the house. MashaAllah. Good life. So she goes and knocks the door. When she knocks the door, some children open the door. And they scream. Who is this witch? One-eyed witch. They don't know that this is their grandmother. Huh? Their grandmother. Now the son comes and he's once again angry. Now he's a grown up. But he's angry that his mother came and scared his children. He says, you old hag, what are you doing here? Why are you scaring my children and why did you come without informing me? If you had told me, I would have sent them somewhere else and I would have been there to talk to you or whatever you wanted to speak with me. Why did you come uninformed? The mother, she was hurt. She was hurt. But quietly, she says, I'm sorry, I think I've come to the wrong house. And she leaves. She leaves. Now after a few years, this boy, now he's a grown up, he's invited to a school reunion in his hometown, where he left long time back. This was from his primary school. I told you he was playing with his friends when his mother came to visit him. So he's invited, he tells his wife some other story, and he goes for the reunion. He participates in it, it's an old boys thing, old boys association, whatever it may be. He finishes it and he thinks, you know, let me go visit the old shack. You know, let me go visit the old hut. He thinks of his house as a shack because now he's living in a palace. Huh? So he said, let me go visit the old shack just out of curiosity. He goes, the house is deserted. There's no one around. He knocks the door, no one to answer. The house is deserted. Then he asks the neighbors as to where is that old lady who was living in the house. Then they tell him that, you know, she died a few weeks back. She died a few weeks back. Then he goes on to say, okay, I'm her son and I just came to visit her. Oh, you're the son. Okay, she left a small parcel for you. And then they give him the parcel. Now the boy opens the parcel. It's just one letter. He opens the letter and he starts reading. The mother says, my dear son, when I got the news that you are going to come for this reunion, I was in such a state of happiness because I was looking forward to meet you. I missed you so badly, my son. And then she goes on to say, but I feel my health is not that great. So I have a feeling and I fear that I might not be there when you come for the reunion. And there is something I want to tell you, my dear son. And then she writes, my son, I still remember the day when I came to pick you from school and you were upset that your friends mocked you. They made fun of you saying that, who is this pirate? Who is this lady with the one eye? Who is this witch? And I want to tell you the story of my one eye. When you were born, you had a problem with one of your eyes. And there was a need to do a corneal transplantation. You know what corneal transplant? The cornea is the outer layer of the eye where you remove it and do a transplant. It was needed. There was no one to do it. Your father was not there. I immediately volunteered and gave you my eye, basically, the cornea, my eye. I gave you my eye so that you would be able to see the world beautifully around you. So that you would be able to live in this world as a normal human being. I gave you my one eye. So this is why I became a one-eyed person. Now the son started crying. The son started crying, but it's too late. It's too late. His mother has passed away. So my dear brothers in Islam, my advice to you, don't wait till it's too late. You have no guarantee. Or you who have bitter feelings with your parents. Today we hear many stories, fathers having problems with their sons. They can't see things in the same light. So this is a good opportunity for me to address the youth and talk to you all specially, because if you're talking in a khutbah, you're talking to a mixed audience of different ages. But still, everybody, it actually applies for everyone, but especially us. Because at times our parents are old. Our parents are old. And we have no guarantee when we sleep tonight that all of us are going to wake up tomorrow. Especially them, as their health is gradually leaving them. He's gradually leaving them. So my advice to you all, you want to enter Jannah, go patch up if you have any problems with your parents. Patch it up immediately. For if not, there's another very important story which I want to share with you all, the importance of a mother. For if not, we all know the dua of our parents are accepted immediately, no doubt, no doubt. So we want their du'as to be in favor of us. So for that, my dear brothers in Islam, we need to work towards it, patch up problems, and be at our parents' beck and call, especially our mothers, because they're weak. At times they can't go out, they need mahram. And when she wants to go out somewhere with you, you know you're busy with your games, and you don't want to go. That slight feeling in her heart, she feeling hurt, might affect you for your whole life, my dear brothers in Islam. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all understand the value of our parents and help us to serve them in the best of manners. The next story, my dear brothers in Islam, is a hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. Allahu Akbar. Listen to this amazing hadith. Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, he narrates this hadith. And he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that three children spoke in the cradle. Three children spoke whilst they were in the cradle. How old is a child when he or she is in the cradle, my dear brother? How old? Just guess. 1 year? No. Even smaller. Cradle, you know cradle? Perhaps a few months. 9 months, 6 months, 4 months. You guys are with me, right? Okay. So three children spoke in the cradle. So who are these three children? Anybody knows? MashaAllah, very big child here. The child of the? Yes, mashallah, mashallah. Including with that, then four children. There's one more child. One more. Okay, I'll mention in the hadith. Okay? So, number one, Isa ibn Maryam. Who is he, Isa ibn Maryam? Big long name, Isa ibn Maryam. Anybody? Isa alayhi salam, Isa ibn Maryam, Isa the son of Maryam. Jesus alayhi salatu was salam. Huh? Look at the ayat in Surah Al-Maryam. Ya ukhta Haruna ma kana abuki imra'a saw'in wa ma kanat ummuki baghiya. Maryam alayha salatu was salam, she becomes pregnant with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now she's coming towards her village. The people gather and they come and say, Ya ukhta Harun, O sister of Aaron, also sister of Harun, Aaron alayhi salatu wasalam, your father was never a man of an evil conduct or evil character, nor was your mother an unchaste woman. They're saying, how could you have become pregnant just like that? You must have been involved in something evil. If not, how can you become pregnant? How can a woman become pregnant by herself? So they come up. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's instruction to Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam was to keep quiet. To keep quiet. So what does she do? فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. What does she do? She points to the child. Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, she's having Isa alayhi salatu wasalam in her arms. She points to the child. The people around, قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. They ask, how can we speak to one who is in the cradle as a child? How can we speak to a child? This is nonsense. You're pointing to the child. How can the child engage in a conversation with us? Lo and behold, the child. قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ أَتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا. The child starts to speak. Allahu Akbar. The newborn child says, Inni Abdullah. I am Abdullah. Or I am the slave of Allah. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is talking. I am the slave of Allah. Atani al-kitaba wa ja'alani nabiyya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me a scripture, al-kitab, and made me a prophet. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. And he has blessed me wherever I am, and he has enjoined upon me prayer, salah and zakah as long as I remain alive. وبرًا بوالدتي ولم يجعلني جبارًا شقيًا. And he made me beautiful to my mother, and he has not made me a wretched tyrant. والسلام علي يوم ولدت ويوم أموت ويوم أبعث حيا. And peace be upon me the day I was born, and the day I will die, and the day I am raised again. I'm resurrected. Allahu Akbar. Now this is the story in regard to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. The second child is the child in the story of Juraij. Now this is the story I want to talk to you about. Just let's quickly run through it. The story of Juraij. Now who is Juraij? Have you heard about Juraij? Prophet? No. Then what is he? Angel? No. Anybody knows the story of Juraij? Lift your hands. Juraij, ring a bell anywhere? Paul Walker? All know, huh? Astaghfirullah. Alright, anyway, let's listen to the story of Juraij now. Juraij was from the Banu Israel. He was from the Banu Israel. He was a pious, an abid, a worshipper, who used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Scholars of tafsir mention that he tried business. Okay, he tried business and then he faced a loss and he made a profit and then he started thinking, this is a waste of time. You know, making money is a waste of time. This dunya is not for business. And he went. He went to involve himself in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 24/7. So he's worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One day he's praying. He's in salah. He is in salah. And his mother comes to where he is. He has a place like a monastery where he used to involve in ibadah. Now the mother comes and she calls, Ya Juraij! The mother is calling. Now remember, my dear brothers in Islam, that first and foremost, he was in nafil salah. You understand? He was in nafil salah, not the fard salah. So there is permission to leave your salah if your mother calls. So now he was an abid. Okay, scholars mentioned that he did not have the fiqh, or he was not an alim. He was just an abid, the worshipper, and that's why we say the importance of knowledge is extremely important. You need to have fiqh to understand the rulings. So he's in salah, Ya Rabbi, Ummi wa salati. Now he's confused. My mother or my salah? My mother or my salah? But then he says, salah is important, and he continues in salah. The mother goes away. Day two, mother comes again. Ya Juraij! Again, Ya Rabbi. Ummi wa salati. It's my mother or my salah? My mother or my salah? Let it be my salah, and he continues with his salah. The third day, the mother comes again. Ya Juraij! Ya Rabbi. Ummi wa salati. He says, Ummi wa salati. He is confused, and he continues with his salah. The mother is hurt. The mother is upset. And then she immediately prays against Juraij because she's upset. See, this is what I said, my dear brothers in Islam. Our mothers, they love us. They love us. And they wouldn't ever want to curse us. But at that, at the spur of that moment, when their heart is broken, when they think, of all the good that I have done to this child, but look at how he behaves, even that ill feeling would result in a curse. Even that slight ill feeling. So she prays at that moment, Ya Allah, let Juraij not pass away from this dunya until he looks at the face of a zaniya, a prostitute. Allahu Akbar. And she leaves. Now after some time, after a long time now, Juraij, the people around his monastery, especially when you talk about a scholar also, you won't always find people who only admire. There are people who have ill feelings, there are people who talk bad too. Huh? So there was a group of people who were against Juraij, in the sense they were not happy about him. They were jealous of him. They were jealous of how close he was with Allah. They were jealous of the environment he was in. He was in a beautiful place. He did so much of miracles. Food used to come to him, come to his feet. The deer, the animals of the jungle used to come and give him milk. Things were going so beautifully for him. So they were jealous of him. They called a zaniya who was beautiful, a prostitute, an adulteress who was beautiful, and asked her to go and seduce Juraij. This zaniya, she goes with the intention of seducing Juraij. She goes and tries to, seduce him, but she fails. Because Juraij, after all, he had the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He refused and he stood away from her. So she faced defeat. Now she's coming back from his monastery. She sees a shepherd. And then an idea clicks. She goes and seduces the shepherd. She goes and seduces the shepherd and becomes pregnant through that very illegal act, the fornication that she commits with the shepherd. And when the child is born, she goes to the town people and she says, "This is the child of Juraij." She makes a blasphemous accusation that Juraij committed an evil act with me and this child belongs to Juraij. Allahu Akbar. She accuses Juraij of adultery, fornication. Now what happens? The people, townspeople, they become enraged. How could Juraij have done this? Juraij, who is known as an abid, a worshipper, how could he have done this? They all rush to the monastery and they destroy his monastery. They destroy his monastery, and when he sees them destroying it, he rushes and comes and asks, "What are you people doing? What are you people doing?" And then they get together and beat him up too. "Oh, you evil person, you hypocrite. You show us one picture while you have committed zina with this woman." Juraij is astounded. What are you talking about? I don't understand. Then they say, "Is this not your child?" Then Juraij says, "Bring that child here. Bring that child here." And the minute the child was brought, he pokes the belly of the child and says, "Oh child, tell us who your father is." And that child opens its mouth and says, "My father is the shepherd from this valley." Allahu Akbar. This is one of the miracles. Miracles. Now Juraij, because he was close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him. But still, you saw the fitna. Did you see the fitna he went through? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him through a test because of the dua of his mother against him. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always help us to get the du'as of our mothers in favor of us. Okay? So my dear brothers in Islam, and afterwards what those townspeople they say is, "Oh, now they realize, Allahu Akbar, Juraij, you're indeed an awliya, you're a pious slave of Allah, we're sorry that we broke your monastery, can we build it back in gold? Can we build it back in gold?" Juraij says, "My dear brothers, I don't need it in gold, just build it back the way it is with using mud and clay," and they build it back. The third child, as the brother here said, the child of the ditch, I won't go into that, but I want to mention the other child. The fourth child was a child from the Banu Israel. From the Banu Israel. I'll quickly run through it. The mother was feeding this child, and then a horseman, a very handsome horseman, runs with his horse, gallops fast, looking very well dressed, fine dressed horseman. The mother, she prays. She prays, "Ya Allah, make my child like this horseman. Make my child like this horseman." The child takes Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he describes the hadith and says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even indicated as to how the child was breastfeeding from the mother by sucking his thumb. Okay? And then the child takes its mouth away from the breast of the mother and says, "Ya Allah, don't make me like that horseman. Don't make me like that horseman." And goes back to drinking the milk. Look at that. A child suddenly gets and says, "Ya Allah, don't make me like the horseman." Allahu Akbar. After a while, a slave goes past. And then the mother, a slave who is being beaten and dragged. People are dragging him and going, accusing him of theft. Huh? Accusing him of theft. Then the mother immediately prays, "Ya Allah, don't make my child ever go through this or become like this slave." The child takes its mouth away from the breast and says, "Ya Allah, make me like this slave." The mother is confused. "Child, what are you talking about?" The child explains, "Mother, the horseman who went in the beginning, he was an oppressor, a tyrant. He was from the ruling family, but a tyrant, a sinner. Allah should never make me as such." And the slave who was being dragged for theft, in reality, he had never robbed anything. He had not robbed anything. He has been accused unjustly. Unjustly. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is with him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's reward is with him because he has been accused unjustly. Indeed, he is going to Jannah. He will be stoned, but he will be going to Jannah immediately. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me like that slave. This was the third child. Now, my dear brothers in Islam, we're done with that hadith. Now let's enter Jannah. We spoke about the gateway of Jannah. Huh? Now we're going to enter Jannah. We're going to take a tiny stroll through the gardens of Jannah. Why? Because however much we try, however eloquent the speaker be, or however immersive the description may be in a book, no human can ever encompass the description of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when speaking about Jannah, what did he say? Al-Jannatu ma la aynun ra'at. Allahu Akbar. A very powerful hadith. Al-Jannatu ma la aynun ra'at, wa la udhunun sami'at, wa la khatara ala qalbi bashar. Jannah, paradise, is something that no eye has ever seen, nor any ear has ever heard, وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ, nor has it ever crossed the mind of any human being. It has never crossed the mind of any human being. This is the speciality of Jannah. And why is it known as Jannah? Jannah, the word Jannah, the Arabic term, comes from the same term as Jinn. Jinn? Jinn or Janin. Janin is, you have Jinn, you know, mankind and Jinnkind. And Janin, which is known as fetus, the children within the womb. All of these stem from the same meaning, which means concealed. Has any one of you all seen a jinn? Jinn? Brother, you're Abdul Sattar's brother, right? Your name? Abdul? Abu Talha, mashallah. Abu Talha, have you seen a jinn? No. You want to see a jinn? Abdul Sattar, you have seen a jinn? No, good, huh? So, no, many of us haven't seen jinnat, huh? Many of us haven't seen jinnat. So they are concealed. In general, some human beings can see jinn, okay? But in general, they are concealed from the eyes of mankind. And that's why they're known as jinn. Now, janin, fetus, the children in the womb. You can't see that too because it is hidden in the womb. So that's why it's known as janin. And likewise, jannah. None of us have seen jannah. It is a garden hidden from sight. Hidden from sight. No one has seen it. And وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ, it has not crossed the minds of any human being. Why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said this powerful statement is, my dear brothers in Islam, you would wonder, now when we have the description of Jannah, we have perhaps rivers of honey, rivers of milk, rivers of wine. Of course, I can imagine it. What's the problem? Why can't it cross my mind? Let me give you an example. One of the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, that, now we're talking about the palaces, the tents of Jannah, the tents of Jannah, one tent, say brother, your tent in Jannah would be a pearl. A pearl. How big is a pearl? A pearl is this big. You know pearls, right? So, your tent would be a pearl which would be hollow in the middle. It would be hollowed out in the middle, and you know what the size of that pearl would be? Some narrations say 30 miles in height. 30 miles in height. Okay? In another narration, 60 miles in height. Allahu Akbar. Can you imagine this? Can you imagine a pearl 30 miles in height? Has it ever crossed your mind? A pearl which is going to be hollowed out. Just imagine, what kind of architecture is this? You will not find it in Dubai or Qatar or anywhere you go. None of the Burj Al Arab or Burj Khalifa or whatever it may be. This architecture is amazing. A pearl 30 miles, 60 miles, Allahu Akbar, hollowed out in the middle. So this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ, it has never crossed the minds of any human being. So now, before we go into Jannah, let's look at Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam's tour of Jannah. We are going into a stroll around Jannah. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam, VIP, isn't it? He's a VIP. So he's got a VIP pass. He took the VIP pass and had a tour of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Look at this hadith. Abu Huraira once again, radiyallahu anhu, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said, لما خلق الله الجنة والنار أرسل جبريل عليه السلام إلى الجنة. When Allah the Almighty created Jannah, paradise, and when He created Jahannam, nar, fire, hell, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salam to Jannah and he said, فقال انظر إليها وإلى ما أعددت لأهلها فيها. Jibreel alayhi salam, go to Jannah and just have a look at what I have created and what I have reserved for the people of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. The hadith goes on. Jibreel alayhi salam now goes to Jannah and has a look around. After having a look around, he comes and says, وعزتك, Ya Allah, by your might and your glory, لا يسمع بها أحد إلا دخلها. If any human being were to hear about Jannah, he would immediately enter into it. It is so beautiful and so amazing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does Allah do? فَأَمَرَ بِهَا فَحُفَّتْ بِالْمَكَارِهِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then commands and orders that the Jannah be surrounded with makarih. Makarih means the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of the what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram, it is surrounded around Jannah. So only if you stay away from what Allah has prohibited can you enter Jannah. Now Allah says, Jibreel, go and have a look at it now. Now Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam goes once again and has a look, and then he comes back and says, Ya Allah, wa izzatik, laqad khashitu an la yadkhulaha ahadun. Now I had a look, Ya Allah, by your might and your glory, I don't think anybody would stand a chance to enter Jannah. Why? Because it's so difficult. It's so difficult. Because my dear brothers in Islam, we're going into the description of Jannah. Remember, Jannah is not cheap. Jannah is not cheap. Today you want to own a Lamborghini? Huh? Anybody likes to own a Ferrari? You do? Bugatti? Range Rover? You like? All of us do, but you know it's difficult. It's difficult. You have to slave and earn, especially in our country with the taxes and all of this. You won't be able to buy a Lamborghini over here. You'll have to strive your whole life. So if dunya, this dunya which is going to be destroyed, this dunya which is nothing, not even worth a wing of a mosquito, this dunya, not even worth a wing of a mosquito, this dunya, then just imagine Jannah with everything, how valuable it is, and how much we need to strive and work hard towards it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all bless us. May Allah bless us all with Jannah. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does He do? He sends Jibreel alayhi salam, now go and have a look at Jahannam. Now, go and have a look at Jahannam. Jibreel alayhi salam now goes to Jahannam and has a look at it and comes back. Now terrified. Ya Allah, he says, he goes and notices that Jahannam is on layers, one upon the other. And then he comes, Ya Allah, وَعِزَّتِكَ لَا يَدْخُلُهَا أَحَدٌ Ya Allah, by your might and your glory, if anyone were to hear about Jahannam, we will inshallah do a description about Jahannam too. If anyone were to hear about Jahannam, they would not even dare get close to it. It is so terrifying, so scary. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commands, فَأَمَرَ بِهَا فَحُفَّتْ بِالشَّهَوَاتِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands and decrees that Jahannam be surrounded with shahawat. What is shahawat? Lusts and desires, temptations. Jahannam is surrounded with it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Jibreel alayhi salam, now you go and have a look at it once again. Jibreel alayhi salam goes and comes back and says, Ya Allah, وَعِزَّتِكَ لَقَدْ خَشِيتُ أَلَّا يَنْجُوَ مِنْهَا أَحَدٌ إِلَّا دَخَلَهَا I fear, Ya Allah, that no one will be able to escape from Jahannam, because the chances to fall into those pits are so easy. Lust and temptation, sins, whatever is surrounding Jahannam, it is very difficult for a person to stay away from those. They would fall into Jahannam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the fire of hell. Now, my dear brothers in Islam, regarding the real gates of Jannah, how many gates are there for Jannah? Aman? 7. Sure. Anybody else? 10. Come on. How many gates has your house got? One gate. The garage gate? 2 then. How many gates has Jannah got? 8. 7. 7, lift your hands. Okay. 7, huh? 8? Only this brother. And he was halfway. 7, 8, 7 and a half. 8? So lift it well. 8, mashallah. So, fil jannati thamaniyatu abwab. How many aman? 8 gates. Jannah has 8 gates. Jazakallahu khair. The brother knows his stuff, huh? Inshallah. His house has 1 gate and he knows Jannah has 8 gates. So, thamaniyat abwab. So, Jannah has 8 gates. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that, fil jannati thamaniyat abwab, fiha babun yusamma rayyan, la yadukhuluhu illa sa'imun, muttafaqun alayhi. Hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Huh? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that Jannah has eight gates, different gates. And one of it is known as Ar-Rayyan. Anybody knows who will enter it? Rayyan, VIPs, who? MashaAllah. The ones who fast, the Sa'imun, only they will enter through Rayyan. Likewise, you have a gate of Sadaqah, you have a gate of Jihad, a gate for Salah. All of those who excel in each of these good deeds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will admit them entry into Jannah through these special gates. Jannah has eight gates, don't forget it, okay? Now what happens, my dear brothers in Islam? We reach the gates of Jannah, Allahu Akbar, just imagine. Now we enter Jannah and we will see a light. A huge light. And at that point, you know what we'll be thinking of? Example, we go to some big hotel and we see a big light. What do we think? We think something important is going on. Huh? We see something important is going on. Allah says in Surah Az-Zumar, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ طِبْتُمْ فَادْخُلُوهَا خَالِدِينَ What happens? They enter the gates of Jannah and there will be throngs of Malaika. This is the light. The huge light will be so much of Malaika gathering to welcome all of us. And what will they say? Salamun alaykum tibtum fadkhuluha khalidin. They would say, Assalamu alaykum, peace be upon all of you all. Tibtum, indeed you all have done good. Indeed you all have become pure. Indeed you all are blessed. Fadkhuluha khalidin. Welcome and enter and abide in this Jannah forever and ever. Allahu Akbar. We are entering Jannah now. Just imagine all of us now. I am the tour guide. Okay? I am the tour guide and we are all entering into Jannah, alright? Beautiful. Now, the gates of Jannah will be swung open and we will be amazed at the illuminating light at the gates of Jannah, like I said, because of the number of Malaika. The Malaika will be so great in number that we will be amazed. They will be the doorkeepers of Jannah. They will welcome us with these beautiful words. And now we take our stroll into the gardens of Jannah. Now when we enter, the minute we enter, now at times you're wondering, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Allah the Almighty says, run to the forgiveness of your Lord. سَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ And run to a garden, to Jannah. What is the size of Jannah? Now Allah mentions in this ayah, what is the size of Jannah? Anybody knows the size of Jannah? How many acres? How many perches? 7 perches? How many perches? Allah says, عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ The square footage of Jannah, the real estate of Jannah, is the 7 heavens and the 7 earths combined. Allahu Akbar. What a vast area. What a vast area. And now when you enter into such a big place at times today in this dunya, when we enter into a big hotel or what? A museum? We are lost. We are lost. So just imagine entering into Jannah, the real estate is the 7 heavens and the 7 earths. We human beings would be insignificant and we'll also be lost. But my dear brothers in Islam, on that day when we enter the gates of Jannah, automatically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have ingrained it within us. We would know, now for example, brother, where is your house? Arthu Salain. Huh? Arthu Salain, this brother lives in Arthu Salain. So now if I were to ask him, guide me to your house, he would tell you, Shaykh, you go through Gold Road, okay, now it's broken over there, there's a lot of traffic. Go through Frederica Road and then come down. Where? Hampden Lane? No, what is that? Peterson Lane and then Hampden Lane and then put it through Arthur Salain from the back. Why? Because he knows his house. Aman, where do you live? Dehivala. He would guide you to Dehivala. Aqil would tell you how to reach Quarry Road. Abdul Sattar would tell you how to reach Alexandra Road. Huh? And then other brothers where they live, they would tell us where we could go to their houses. They know it at the, like the back of their hands. Why? Because they go there often. Likewise, my dear brothers in Islam, when we enter Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have ingrained it within us. We would know where our palaces are. Allahu Akbar. We would know where our palaces are. We would automatically, as we enter, start moving. Aman would go to his palace. This brother would go to his palace. That brother would go to that palace. Nawfar would go to his palace. We would all go to our palaces. I will go to my palace. Huh? So we'll all know the address of our palaces. And we would move to our palaces. And the hadith, my dear brothers in Islam, it goes on to say that we would know our palaces better than our own homes in this world. Allahu Akbar. We would know our palaces better than our own homes. Better than you know how to get to Al-Tusalain. Better than how you know how to get to Quarry Road. You would know how to get to your palace. Look at the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then now look at this ayah, the ayah that I recited in the beginning. It, you know, gives the description of Jannah in a nutshell. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says,
مثل الجنة التي وعد المتقون فيها أنهار من ماء غير آسٍ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the description of Jannah which the muttaqun, the people of taqwa have been promised, the righteous have been promised, what is in this Jannah?
فِيهَا أَنْهَارٌ مِّن مَّاءٍ غَيْرِ آسٍ.
There will be rivers. You will have your palace, and you know, underneath your palace, you see in the Quran many a time you see tajri. The word tajri, مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. There will be gardens where rivers will be flowing underneath. So how could you see if the river was flowing underneath? Basically, if your palace, you go to your palace in Jannah, the flow will be of glass and rivers will be flowing underneath. Allahu Akbar. And what types of rivers? Rivers of crystal clear water. Crystal clear water, and that water will never ever go bad. Water, that water will never be, the taste will never alter itself. Crystal clear, pure water. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say,
وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن لَّبَنٍ لَّمْ يَتَغَيَّرْ طَعْمُهُ وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن خَمْرٍ لَّذَّةٍ لِّلشَّارِبِينَ وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن عَسَلٍ مُّصَفًّى وَلَهُمْ فِيهَا مِن كُلِّ الثَّمَرَاتِ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّن رَّبِّهِمْ.
Allahu Akbar. And then there will be rivers of pure white milk. Pure white milk. The taste of that milk which will never ever change. It will never go bad. It would not need any processes of pasteurization or all of those things. It would be fresh all times. And rivers of delicious wine. Rivers of delicious wine. Now the word used is khamr. Khamr, the Arabic word khamr, is generally intoxicant. That which intoxicates you or takes away your intellect. You know what happens when you drink wine? Anybody knows what happens when you drink wine? You go drunk. You start saying things that don't make sense. Huh? The brother will come and start dancing on top of the table. Is he? As wine. So now, is that the same wine we are talking about in Jannah? No. No. This will be wine which will not intoxicate. And this is actually fruit juice. This is actually fruit juice. Why? Because even wine by itself, at times you have pressed grapes. Grapes, when you press it, you get juice. So this will be khamr, which will be fresh fruit juice, which will be so fresh and so delicious. It would not intoxicate you. You're not going to get a hangover next morning. You're not going to have a headache later on. Huh? You won't have a headache. Abdul Sattar's brother, what's your name you said? Abdul? Abu Talha. He's smiling when I say hangover. You know what hangover is, huh? Okay. You never had a hangover? Good, mashallah. Allah save you, inshallah. Alright. Okay. So, delicious wine. And also you would have rivers of sweet and luscious honey. Now remember, when I say honey, it's not the honey of this dunya. When I say milk, it's not the milk of this dunya. When I say wine, it's not the wine of this dunya. When we say gold, silver, it's not the gold and silver of this dunya. Nothing. Why we said? They can never cross the mind of any human being. And as we know, the gold that we have in this dunya is not pure gold. You have your jewelry that you see in gold is generally mixed, or it's an alloy. It is an alloy of two metals. But if you were to have pure gold, it would be very soft and very weak, it would break. That is pure gold. You take honey, it's always diluted. Honey is always diluted. You take milk, milk is always diluted. And when we say milk here, it's the cow's milk. But in Jannah, it's not the cow's milk, it's Jannah's milk. You understand? When we say honey here, it's bee's honey. In Jannah, it is Jannah's honey. You say khamr here, it's wine, alcohol, intoxicants. But over there, it's a different khamr. Different gold, different silver. So there will be sweet and luscious honey. If the honey of the bee, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created here, is so tasty. Huh? There was an amazing fact. I was reading about honey the other day. And they say that, you know, one teaspoon of honey is the lifetime work of one bee. Allahu Akbar. You realize that? Amazing, isn't it? One spoon of honey is the lifetime's work of one bee. You have one spoon of honey, it's a lifetime's work of one bee. Goes around flower to flower, this flower, that flower, striving, collecting little, and makes one teaspoon. And all for what? For somapala. For us. It is for us. It is for us, for the believers, for the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For us not to associate partners unto Him. We don't worship statues. We don't worship anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is our God. He is our Lord. He is our protector, sustainer, nourisher, creator. Huh? So everything has been created for us. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, and they will have all kinds of fruits, and also they will have forgiveness, a special type of forgiveness from their Lord. Now we move on to the trees of Jannah. Now like I said, we enter the garden, we enter through the gates, we know our palace, now we're headed. Now it's not a small area, Allahu Akbar. Your own palace, your own territory would be so vast, it has to be calculated through time. A traveler would have to travel for 100 years perhaps. Many narrations say, the shade of one tree in Jannah, the shade, I'm not talking about the size of the tree, the shade of the tree. A fast rider, a rider on a horse, he'd have to ride really fast. And he would have to ride for 100 years just to cover the shade of one tree. One tree. Now can this cross your mind? Allah, this is Jannah. So now we are moving. So we are moving towards our palace. Like I said, as we enter the gate, you can't rush to your palace. Of course, you would have horses made of rubies, flying horses. Whether you, perhaps, Abu Talha would go inside and say, I want a Bugatti. Where on to go to my house? It'll be there. Presto! And your Lamborghini is there. Your Diablo, you can get into it and go to your house, of course. But still, you have to cross so many things. And now we are crossing the trees of Jannah. How would the trees of Jannah be, my dear brothers in Islam? Like the mango trees in Gold Road, or perhaps the Elephant Road or something like that. How would the trees of Jannah be? The trunks of those trees, some of them will be made of gold and some would be made of silver. Allahu Akbar, can you imagine? Gold and silver. Gold trunk, silver trunk. And the leaves of these trees would be also as if they were gold and silver. And like I said in the beginning, pure gold and pure silver. It will be so pure, it will be as if it is see-through. Everything in Jannah is like that. It will be as if it is see-through. Now we have about the women of Jannah, but I don't even know whether I should talk about the women of Jannah here. The audience, all youngsters here. You won't be able to sleep at night. Maybe your mothers, they wanted to know what's the age group today. I didn't know what to say. I said, everyone is welcome. So then 12 years, 13 years. But then I was wondering, how are we going to talk about the Hura'een now? Now I'd have to skip that topic. Interesting topic, huh? Alright. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with Hura'een. Alright. So we'll just touch it briefly and go. Huh? Touch it briefly. So gold trunks and silver trunks, the trees will be made of. And the leaves, when they start knocking one another, a beautiful music will arise from these trees. And my dear brothers in Islam, if you have got your iPhones and your iPods full of music libraries, pop, rap, this, crap, you have all of this in it, you will be deprived of listening to that music of the trees of Jannah. And that will be the best music that you ever heard. Allahu Akbar. For only if you sacrifice in this dunya, you will get it in Akhirah. A question may arise that whatever you desire in Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give you, right? So if I go to Jannah, I'll desire it and Allah has to give it to me. Allah has to give it to me. But then my dear brothers in Islam, if you have committed that sin in dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah, He would remove that code of desire from your mind so much to the extent that you will not desire it in Akhirah and you will be deprived of it. It will be as if you are deaf, you will not be able to hear it, whilst your brothers, your friends who stayed away from listening to music in this dunya, they will be able to listen to it in Akhirah and they will be enjoying it. But we on the other hand would be deprived of it. If we involve in the sin of music, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the evils of music. We would have to have one lecture completely to cover about the evils of music. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. The best way, my dear brothers in Islam, if you're addicted to it, switch to nasheeds. Switch to nasheed. MashaAllah, we have a good nasheed collection now. Switch to it, and that also nasheeds without music. Now go, don't go and start listening to nasheeds with a booming with music. Then you are in the same pit once again. Listen to nasheeds but do not have music and gradually come out of the addiction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help the brothers who are addicted to music. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the evils and the addictions of music. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now says in the noble Quran, مُتَّكِئِينَ عَلَىٰ فُرُشٍ بَطَائِنُهَا مِنْ إِسْتَبْرَقٍ وَجَنَى الْجَنَّتَيْنِ دَانٍ فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. The people of Jannah, they will be reclining on beds. مُتَّكِئِينَ عَلَىٰ فُرُشٍ. They will be reclining, resting, relaxing on beds. Min istabraq, bata'inuha min istabraq. The linings of those beds will be of silk brocade. Allahu Akbar. Silk is haram for us in dunya. In Jannah there is nothing known as haram. No more haram. We won't need halal certification. Everything halal. Permissible, no haram. So the beds will be of linings which will be of silk brocade. And the fruit of the two gardens will be hanging low. Allahu Akbar. The speciality of the trees of Jannah, my dear brothers in Islam, you would look at the juicy apple hanging there. Now you would not have to climb the tree and pluck it. The minute you think, I want that apple, the tree would reach out and give you the apple. You would just have to pluck the apple whilst you're relaxing, reclining on your bed and start biting it. And that apple, my dear brothers in Islam, each bite will be a different world of flavors. Each bite would have a different world of taste. You will be immersed in that apple itself. Leave alone the other things. You see? You will be preoccupied with different pleasures of Jannah which would keep you busy, which would keep you occupied. Allahu Akbar, Allah give us all Jannah. So the fruits would come to us. Now I told you about the shade of Jannah, that a fast rider would have to travel 100 years to cover it. Now in regard to the food and the drink of Jannah, hadith in Bukhari, that the first meal, you see when you go to some resorts, you go to some resorts, some 5-star, 7-star hotels, what happens when you enter? They come up with a welcome drink. Do they? They come up with a welcome drink and you take the welcome drink and you drink it. Perhaps apple juice, orange juice, you have different welcome drinks. Or perhaps a cocktail. So you have the drink. Now what would be the welcome drink or rather the welcome meal of Jannah? Anybody knows? Roasted chicken. Anybody? What do you think? Grilled beef. The hadith says that the first meal that will be served to the people of Jannah would be a special platter. A special platter, a special plate, a special meal of the liver of the fish. I'm not a great fan of seafood. But anyway, you see, even though you think, okay, liver of the fish, what is this going to be about, my dear brothers in Islam? If it's going to be from Jannah and it's going to be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to give us, it's going to be amazing. It's going to be out of this world, because it is out of this world. It is out of this world. It is going to be the best thing that you've ever tasted. The liver of the fish. That will be the first meal that we will be given, inshaAllah ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with that beautiful meal. And then, what will happen? Now we're talking about the food and the drink of Jannah. Allah says,
وَيُطَافُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِآنِيَةٍ مِّن فِضَّةٍ وَأَكْوَابٍ كَانَتْ قوارير من فضة قدروها تقديرا ويسقون فيها كأسا كان مزاجها زنجبيلا عينا فيها تسمى سلسبيلا.
Now whilst we are in Jannah, there will be circulated amongst us vessels of silver. The plates will be of silver, and goblets, you know goblets, cups, goblets, will be as if they are made of glass. See, I told you it is see-through, but in reality those goblets will be made, min fidda, it will be made of silver, pure silver, which would look as if it is see-through. Goblets made of silver. And what would these goblets be brimming of? What would they be full? وَيُسْقَوْنَ فِيهَا كَأْسًا كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا زَنْجَبِيلًا. They will be given to drink a cup of wine. Of juice, of wine. Its mixture will be of زَنْجَبِيلًا. A type of a special ginger. Now don't think ginger beer. Don't think ginger beer. A special type of ginger. عَيْنًا فِيهَا تُسَمَّى سَلْسَبِيلًا. And where will this special drink come from? It will come from a spring which is known in Jannah as Salsabil. As Salsabil, a special drink. This is what we will be drinking as we go into Jannah. It is a fountain known as Salsabil. Now like I said, in regard to the fruits, whatever you wish. You want a fruit salad, you get a fruit salad of all the fruits. You want a specific fruit, the tree brings it to you. Now you're thinking, I want a roast chicken, or I want the meat of this bird. The bird is flying in the air, you think of it, and the meat will be in your mouth. You think of the bird which is flying in the air, it is in your mouth. You eat, you finish eating, the bird flies and goes away. Allahu Akbar. Amazing, isn't it? This is Jannah. This is Jannah. You think of the bird, you think, I want it grilled, I want it barbecued, I want it broiled, I want it fried. Whatever way you want it, well done, rare, medium, you name it, the bird comes to you. You want a chicken, you want pigeon, you want fowl, whatever you want. In regard to the types of meat, you want sheep, you want goat, cow, lamb, mutton, you name it, rabbit. Every single meat is available, you just have to think about it and it's ready for you. Hot, hot. This is in regard to the food of Jannah. Now what about the clothes? What are we going to be wearing? The brother is going to be wearing his green t-shirt, huh? You know why I said green t-shirt? Because you will be wearing green in Jannah. Green. Yes. Allah says in the Noble Quran,
عَالِيَهُمْ ثِيَابُ سُنْدُسٍ خُضْرٌ وَإِسْتَبْرَقٌ وَحُلُّوا أَسَاوِرَ مِنْ فِضَّةٍ وَسَقَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ شَرَابًا طَهُورًا.
The dwellers of Jannah, the people of Jannah, they will have upon them green garments. So you'll be wearing your green t-shirt. They will have green garments of fine silk and brocade. Once again, it will be of silk and have beautiful embroidery. And they will be adorned with bracelets of silver. And their Lord will give them a purifying drink. We spoke about the drink earlier. Alright? And then it will be said to them, my dear brothers in Islam,
كُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا هَنِيئًا بِمَا أَسْلَفْتُمْ فِي الْأَيَّامِ الْخَالِيَةِ.
It will be said to the people of Jannah, the inhabitants of Jannah, كُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا. Eat and drink as you wish. هَنِيئًا بِمَا أَسْلَفْتُمْ فِي الْأَيَّامِ الْخَالِيَةِ. Why? Because of all the good that you did in your past days. Whilst you were in Jannah, you strived hard, you did good deeds, you stayed away from all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited you to stay away from, and this is your reward, you can eat and drink as you wish. Now in regard to the houses, the dwellings, the palaces of the people of Jannah. Now like I said, my dear brothers in Islam, before we go into the palaces, the tents of the people of Jannah, which will be at the garden, in the gardens of the people of Jannah. The tents are pearls, like I said in the beginning, hollowed out pearls, which will be 30 miles in one narration in height, and in another narration 60 miles. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is reported to have said that he saw a dream. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw a dream, and he saw that he was in Jannah. Now we know the dreams of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa sallam are not like our dreams. Their dreams are true. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now he saw himself in Jannah, and he saw a beautiful palace. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw a beautiful palace, and he thought that, okay, this is my palace. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thought that this is his palace. And there was a beautiful woman making ablution next to that palace. She was making ablution in the sense, she was washing herself. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked as to who this palace belongs to. And it was said that it belongs to Umar radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately turns away. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I turned away because I know of the jealousy of Umar radiallahu an and how protective he is of his women. So I didn't want to be looking at the woman of Umar radiallahu an. Then Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, Ya Rasulullah, will I be jealous if you look? If you look, would I be jealous? So the beautiful hadith, my dear brothers in Islam, the hadith is in Bukhari. So now how will we be in Jannah? Once a lady came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, old lady, alright? She's old. An auntie. She comes to, or a grandma perhaps. She comes to Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, will I go to Jannah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at her and says, I'm sorry, you won't be going to Jannah. The minute Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says this, the lady starts crying and weeping. And she's about to leave. Why will I not go to Jannah? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiles and says, because, my dear mother, you won't go as you are, you will be turned back to how you were when you were a young girl. And then you will be entered into Jannah. Allahu Akbar. She starts smiling. So all of us will be, how old will we be in Jannah? How old are you, brother? Now. 30. You're 30 years old. MashaAllah. 13. He's 13 years old. You, brother? 12. You've got a beautiful smile. So, 12, 13. So, how old will we be in Jannah? 35. Sure. Second opinion, anybody? Aman, something else. Come on. 43, perhaps. No? All 33, unanimous? Yes, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. All of us will be 33 years old. Whether we be 30 now or 70 or 90 or 100, in Jannah, we will be 33. 33, all of us. And how will our faces be? Abu Talha, how will our faces be? Like your face. How will our faces be? All of our faces, yes? How? Yusuf alayhi salam. Well, the narration that I read, our faces will be like the full moon on the 15th night. Our faces will be illuminated. They will be glittering, shining like the full moon. Our faces, Allahu Akbar. Allah says, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. That the faces of the people of Jannah, it will be how? Bright and glittering, إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. And they'll be looking at their Lord. And what will be our height? 6 feet. 60 what? meters, feet. Will be the height of our father Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, 60 cubit length. 60 cubit length. This will be our height. Age 33, faces glittering and shining, and our hearts will be like the hearts of birds. Or rather, our hearts will be like birds themselves. It will be fluttering, full of happiness, free from all types of evil. No anger, no hatred, no jealousy, no malice, no temper, nothing evil. No evil at all. Our hearts will be full of goodness. Our hearts will be like birds. And all of our hearts will be like the heart of one single man. All of our hearts today, our hearts are disunited. Our hearts are disunited. But in Jannah, our hearts will be united like the heart of one single man. And we'll all be united. We will not have ill feelings towards one another. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite all of our hearts. Now in regard to the women of Jannah, let's quickly run through it. Because like I said, the audience is not... Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the women of Jannah beautifully in the Noble Quran. So much to the extent that even whilst you read it, you can't help but smile. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, before we go to that now, what happens is, now we are, before we go into the ayah, now we are walking. We are getting closer and closer to our palace. Are we not? We are getting closer and closer to our palace. And whilst we are going, suddenly we stop. Suddenly we stop. We freeze in our tracks. Why? Because we see something in front of us. And what is that? What is that, brother? Building blocks, for you. What do we see? We see our wife in Jannah. Perhaps it could be the wife that we had in this world. If she is pious and helps us towards Jannah, we would see her in Jannah. Or else our wife from the women of Jannah. When some people say the wife of this dunya, Allah. Some people always say, you're going to see the same woman over there. Anyway. So either the wife who you married here, or you see your wife in Jannah. Alright? Now in regard to them, my dear brothers in Islam, the description, especially Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions in his book, beautiful book, Hadil Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah, lovely book, fantastic read. He says that the women of Jannah, they're known as what? Hur'in. They're known as Hur'in. He says that you see in dunya at times, you see that there are wars. People, men wage wars at times over one woman. Over one woman, just because one woman is beautiful. At times two people fight over one woman. They wage wars over one woman. Imam al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that if the hurutin, in other words, the women of this dunya made of dirt, made of clay, if they can be so beautiful that they cause you sleepless nights and they cause wars being waged over them, then just imagine how the hur na'een will be. Allahu Akbar. The hur, the women who are made of saffron, their essence is saffron, how their beauty would be. And then he goes on to describe them saying, if the women of Jannah, when they smile, their smiles will be like the lightning in the sky. Allahu Akbar. The smiles of the women of Jannah will be like the lightning in the sky. Abu Sattar is already smiling like lightning. So you see, and if she were to put her veil, she's got a veil or her shawl, if even a part of it were to be exposed to this dunya, that veil would outshine the sun. The beauty of the veil, or the brightness of that veil, Brother Shamim, I think you should be listening to this description. The veil, if part of it were to be put out in this dunya, it would outshine the sun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Noble Quran, وَحُورٌ عِينٌ كَأَمْثَالِ اللُّؤْلُؤِ الْمَكْنُونَ. And for the people of Jannah are reserved fair women, حُورٌ عِينٌ, with large beautiful eyes. And it is known that if you have big large eyes, it is a sign of beauty. And the example given to these women are of pearls well protected. They are لَمْ يَتْمِثْهُنَّ إِنْسٌ قَبْلَهُمْ وَلَا جَانٌ. no man or no jinn has ever seen them nor touched them, reserved specially for the people of Jannah. Imam Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he goes on to say in regard to the Quran ayah, وَكَوَاعِبَ أَثْرَابًا, they will be, okay, let's leave the ayah there. They will be young maidens of equal age. General translation, I told you the audience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it in beauty because man is inclined to this. I wanted to touch on another topic, but I'm running short of time. As men in general are inclined towards the beauty of women. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who engineered us and created us, He knows what we want. And then He goes on to say that the women of Jannah, they will be having the liquid of youth flowing through their limbs. And the sun, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he's saying this, that the sun would run along the beauty of her face if she were to ever show her face. And if she were to smile, a light would emit and shine from between her teeth. And if you were to look at her face, you would see the reflection of your own face in the roundness of her cheek. Allahu Akbar. Look at the beauty. And then you would be able to see the brightness from behind her muscles and her bones. Because I told you once again, as gold and silver is pure, likewise even her feet from her, you know, her calves would be as if it is see-through. Maybe it might sound peculiar to hear now, but in Jannah it will be beautiful, extremely beautiful, it will be amazing, something out of this world. And her beauty would fill what is between the heavens and the earth. And if she were to ever look at this dunya, the whole of this dunya would be filled with a beautiful fragrance. Such is the beauty of the women of Jannah, my dear brothers in Islam. And she would be free from all kinds of najasa. Today we have what? We have mucus, we have saliva, we have blood, pus, we go, we pass urine, we pass stool, all of this najasa. But in Jannah, nothing. The Hurun Ain, they are free of all of that, and likewise the people of Jannah, we'll also be free of it. We also will be free of it. So how would we go to the toilet then? Abu Talha, any idea? No? Then we eat, and how do we release what we are eating? Anybody? Huh? Anybody? Sweat. How would you say? You see, a beautiful fragrance would be released in the smell of musk. I'm not saying that you would pass air now, or wind. Huh? A beautiful fragrance would emit in the smell of musk, and that would be all. You would not have to pass stool or pass urine or anything of that sort. And in regard to your hunger and thirst, no matter how much you eat, you will always be full, but you will always have room for more food. You wouldn't be hungry, but you will always be able to eat, and you will always be able to drink. But when you want to stop, you can stop. This is how the feeling of Jannah would be. So my dear brothers in Islam, with that, we move on to the summary. And this summary is given by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah in the same book, Hadil Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah. Very quickly we go through it. He says, if you ask about the ground or the soil of Jannah, then it is of musk and saffron. If you ask about the roof of Jannah, it is the Arshur Rahman, it is the Arsh, the throne of Allah, the Most Merciful. If you ask about the rocks, the pebbles, the parts of Jannah, they are of pearls, diamonds, rubies, jewels. If you ask about the buildings and the dwellings of Jannah, then they are made of bricks, gold, silver, one after the other. And there in between gold and silver, you would have layers of musk. And if you ask about the trees of Jannah, then those trees are made of gold and silver, the trunks of those trees. The trees of Jannah, the trunks are made of gold and silver. If you ask about the fruits of Jannah, then they are softer than butter and sweeter than honey. If you ask about the leaves of the trees of Jannah, then they are softer than the softest of silk. If you ask about the rivers of Jannah, then they are rivers of milk whose taste does not change. Rivers of wine that is so delicious. Rivers of honey that is sweet, luscious and pure. And rivers of water that is crystal clear and fresh. If you ask about the food, then its fruits are from whatever you choose, and the meat of whatever birds you desire. And if you ask about the drink, then it is tasneem, ginger, and kafur, which is camphor. If you ask about their drinking goblets, then they are crystal clear and made of gold and silver. And if you ask about the shade of the trees of Jannah, then a fast rider would have to ride for 100 years to try and cover the shade of Jannah. If you ask about the vastness of Jannah, the last person to ever enter Jannah, the lowest in degree, he would have his Jannah, would be the real estate a rider would have to travel 1,000 years to cover. The last person, the least daraja in Jannah. If you ask about the tents and encampments of Jannah, then the tents are like concealed, hollowed out pearls that are 60 miles in height. If you ask about the towers, then they are castles. They are rooms above rooms in buildings that have rivers running underneath them. If you ask about how far it reaches into the sky, it would be as far as how far your eyesight would reach. If you ask about the clothing of the people of Jannah, then they are of silk and gold and green embroidery. If you ask about the beds and the blankets of Jannah, they are of the finest silk in the highest levels of luxury. Highest levels of luxury. And if you ask about the faces of the people of Jannah, they are like the full moon. Their age will be 33 in the image of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, the father of humanity. And likewise, my dear brothers in Islam, he goes on to say that fiha ma tashtahihi al-anfus wa taladdu al-a'yun. In Jannah will be whatever your soul desires, wa taladdu al-a'yun, and your eyes will be feasting. You know feasting? You feast with your mouth. But in this case, your eyes will be feasting on all of these beautiful spectacles, all of these beautiful sights. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. And for them in Jannah will be whatever they desire. وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there is one more thing, a bonus. Mazid, which I have kept for them. Now what is this mazid, my dear brothers in Islam? Just give me another 3 minutes and I wrap it up by mentioning what is mazid. Now we have reached our palaces, enjoying. Now, brothers, we are seated by the rivers of Jannah. Just imagine, now you need to imagine this spectacle. It is indeed a beautiful spectacle. We are by the rivers of Jannah, goblets in our hands. You feel thirsty, you put the goblet into the river and take a cup of milk. Aqil would take a cup of juice. Huh? You would take a cup of water perhaps. And we are drinking, we are talking. We talk about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. We talk about Umar radiallahu anhu. We talk about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On that day, my dear brothers in Islam, we will be by the rivers. And we would be with Umar radiallahu anhu. We would be with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. We would be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We would be talking happily by the rivers of Jannah. And suddenly we would hear a caller calling out, Ya Ahl al-Jannah. Now the minute we hear this caller, my dear brothers in Islam, a fear would grip our hearts. A fear would grip the hearts of the people of Jannah. Why? Who is calling us? And why are we being called? Now we have got used to the luxury. We have got used to the beautiful sight. Now why is someone calling us? Are they going to deprive us of this beautiful Jannah? Is Allah going to throw us out of Jannah? Why are we being called? And all of us would get up and look towards this caller. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentions this in the book Hadil Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah. Listen to it carefully, my dear brothers in Islam. We would look towards the caller. And that caller would look at us and say, O people of Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most powerful, the most gracious, the most merciful, has extended an invitation to all of y'all that y'all visit Him. Allahu Akbar. Allah the Almighty, Allah who created all of this, all this description that I gave you, Allah created for you and me. For you and me, He has extended an invitation that we visit Him. Just imagine the excitement. Just imagine what would be running in our hearts at that moment. Allah has invited us. Today we say the President invites us and we are excited. Or so and so invites us, we are excited. On that day, it's Allah's invitation. we all get up and now we are rushing. Some in their horses, some in their cars, some in their all types of conveyances, Lamborghinis, Ferraris, Abu Talha. You'll all be rushing now where? To meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we go to a particular valley. We go to a particular valley where we have been instructed to go. When we reach that valley, my dear brothers in Islam, suddenly a huge light would break out. A huge light. And we would all be amazed by that light, and suddenly the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be visible. We will see the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And just as we are looking at the arsh of Allah, another light would break out around us, and suddenly manabir, pulpits, you know pulpits? Of light, of jewels, pearls, emeralds, rubies would start breaking out from the ground and coming out. And for whom are these mimbar, are these manabir, are these pulpits for, my dear brothers in Islam? For you and me to sit, Allahu Akbar. For you and me to sit, pulpits of light, pulpits of jewels, rubies, emeralds, diamonds. And we would sit in all of these manabir, my dear brothers in Islam. Now you travel with me, imagine the spectacle with me, my dear brothers in Islam. Suddenly, now a voice would break out. Whose voice would this be, my dear brothers in Islam? It would be the voice of Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, Ya Ahlal Jannah, O people of Jannah, Salamun alaykum. Allahu Akbar. What a privilege. What a privilege. Our beloved Maker, who we prostrate unto every single day, that Allah who we have not seen, who we believe, Allah the Almighty, the most merciful, the most gracious, who created every single thing in this world and the hereafter for us, who loves us so much, He is saying, Peace be unto you. Allah who is As-Salam, peace by Himself, He is saying peace be unto you. And what do you think our reply would be on that day, my dear brothers in Islam? Allahumma anta as-salam, wa minka as-salam, tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. We would all reply in unison. We would all reply together, Allah, you are as-salam, wa minka as-salam, and from you is salam. Tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. We would all reply together. And then, my dear brothers in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, Oh my dear slaves, the slaves who worship me without even seeing me, without even having ever glanced at me. Today is the day of mazid. I said, لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُنَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيد. Today is the day of mazid. So you may ask whatever you wish and I will grant it. Whatever you want. All of us would say, Ya Allah, you have given us everything. There is nothing more that we can ask. What more can we ask? Whatever we desire, you have given. Allah will once again say, today is the day of mazid. Ask what you wish. And then all of us together, we would say, Ya Allah, arina wajhak. Ya Allah, show us your beautiful and blessed face. My dear brothers in Islam, this is an opportunity never to be missed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with the sight towards His beautiful face. We would all say, Ya Allah, show us your beautiful face. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did He say? I would do what you say. I will grant your wish. And then Allah the Almighty would remove all of the veils that prevent us from seeing Him. You know, even Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, you know the story. He saw just a part of the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which was reflected on towards a mountain. And for that he fainted. This is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah would remove all of the veils. Some narration says 70,000 veils. Allah would remove all of them. And Allah would will and decree that His light should not harm any of us. And my dear brothers in Islam, scholars mention that the minute we see Allah's face, Ya Allah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with the beautiful sight. Scholars mention, we would be transfixed in that location for years and years and years and years, just looking at the blessed face of our powerful Creator. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, indeed, it is amazing. It is something I cannot put into words to make you understand. And I hope you'll understand the magnanimity of this spectacle. We will be transfixed We will be frozen in that location, staring at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah the Almighty will talk to every single slave of His. Allah will talk to every single slave of His saying, "Oh my dear slave, you did this sin on this day and on that day." Privately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will talk. And then He'll say, "You did this. I know this, brother, you did this on this day." Not brother, slave of Allah. Allah will say, "Slave of Allah, you, my slave, you did this on this day and on that day. All the sins that we committed." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says, "We the humble slaves," we would say, "Ya Allah, yes, I did so. Yes, yes, Ya Allah, please forgive me." And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, "My dear slave, if not for my maghfirah, if not for my forgiveness, you will not be here." Allahu Akbar. We all have to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear brothers in Islam. For it is only through the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is only through tawbah, by us turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can we get Jannah. It is not through our good deeds. Some would come with mountains of good deeds and every single thing will be thrown back because of lack of sincerity, or perhaps because they did it for show. It is only through the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we will be able to enter Jannah. And like I said in the beginning, no human can ever try to give you a full description or a full tour of Jannah. That's why we named it as a stroll. A stroll is a small walk through Jannah, where we discuss a few aspects of Jannah, just as how it is mentioned by our beloved Creator and our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the noble Quran and the Ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anything more than that, we do not go. We only rely upon the Quran and the Sunnah to determine these things that are from the ghaybiyat, that are from the unseen, that which no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, nor has it crossed the minds of any human being. And with that, my dear brothers in Islam, we conclude today's lecture. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us and forgive all of our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our good deeds. And may Allah the Almighty save us all from the evil consequences of our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the adverse consequences of our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as how He united us together today, may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with the highest stations in Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive the sins of our parents and bless them immensely. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them the very best in this world and the hereafter. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive the sins of those parents who have passed away. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant all of them the highest darajat, the highest maqam, the highest stations in Jannah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of us. Wa akhir da'wa ya'ani alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. And jazakumullahu khair, my dear brothers, for participating.